for leading us in worship this morning. Would you bow your head with me in a word of prayer? Eternal God, we do thank you for this day. We thank you for your goodness toward us. We thank you, God, for bringing us one more time to this place. Lord, we do not take it for granted that we would be here. And so, Lord God, we do thank you for this opportunity to worship, this opportunity to hear your word, and this opportunity to be in your presence. And so, Father, I pray that the words that I speak, that I have meditated on, that I have studied, oh God, that they would be acceptable in your sight. Lord God, you are our strength, you are our redeemer, and you are our soon coming king, and we love you this day. And we ask it all in the precious and powerful name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our own people of God say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. We are continuing today with Jesus' conversation, an invitation with two men that we introduced last week. They were on a mission to gain a better understanding about Jesus. Invitations are pretty commonplace when we want people to share big moments with us, or we just want them to be in our company. There are, of course, different kinds of invitations, and some of them require a response, an RSVP, if you will, meaning that the other party wants you to confirm whether or not you will be present, and also there's usually a restriction as to how many people can attend. This is what we do so that we can accommodate all of our guests. Yet you will notice that when Jesus extends an invitation, he does not need us to adhere to these strict guidelines. It is usually an open-ended invitation, and you can bring your whole family. You can bring your neighbors, you can bring your friends, you can bring your coworkers, you can even bring your enemies. There is no limit to how many he can accommodate. This is the kind of open-ended invitation that was extended last week to the two of John's disciples who started following Jesus from afar. They wanted to know more about him, and that was obvious in the way that they addressed him when they responded to his question, "Why are you following me?" They were not quite ready to declare Jesus the Lamb of God like John the Baptist had done. They, on the other hand, referred to him as rabbi or teacher. They were very noticeably in two different places in their commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. John addressed Jesus by the title that expressed his deepest understanding and level of commitment, and so did the two disciples of John. They were not yet Jesus' disciples, but they realized that they needed a teacher. They needed understanding before they could commit, and Jesus, without pressuring them, said, "Come and see. Give me the opportunity to change your thinking about who I am, and come and see and give me an opportunity to share with you what I really care about." He did not give them any warning that what he would teach them would be radically different from what their current culture practiced or understood. But there was good reason to be hopeful because they were the ones looking for the teacher. So the question is, what did he want to teach them? And why did he say, "Come and see"? That is what I want to explore this morning. Now, this is Jesus' first major teaching that we read in the scriptures this morning that Austin read, that we did responsibly. The text said that when he was seated, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth and taught them. You know, just as an aside, when I read this, it just kind of caused me to just think about how we have sort of turned things around. Jesus was sitting, and the people were standing. So maybe one Sunday we'll try that. I'll sit in, and you'll stand. But anyway, he wanted to teach them the true meaning of being blessed in his kingdom. It stands to reason that he wanted to be as radically different and set apart from the Pharisees as he could. He wanted to change the thinking of his followers and wannabes so that they would be able to make declarations about who they would become should they choose to follow him. Some commentators suggest that Jesus actually wanted to shock them with his teaching as he would redefine who is really blessed. He was very intentional and well aware of how the leaders of his day thought, which has not changed very much from the way people think today, which is amazing to me in and of itself. They thought that only the wealthy, the mighty, the strong, and the powerful were blessed. But Jesus did not include any of them, in fact. He wanted them to change their thinking just on the meaning of the word blessed and blessing, and who the benefactors of God's blessing would be. And so I thought I would do a little bit of research and look to see, what do people really think about this word blessed? So I went out to Facebook and I looked up, I did a search on the hashtag blessed. Now, for those of you that use Facebook, you know exactly what I'm talking about. For those of you that don't use Facebook, it's just simply this. On your keyboard, there is the pound sign, and I don't even know why we, well, I know why we start calling it hashtags, but anyway. So it's the pound sign on your keyboard. If you put that in front of a word, it will group them into a category. So if you want to see all of the things that people said about blessed, if you go to hashtag blessed, you'll be able to see it. If you went to hashtag marriage, you would see all the things that people have to say. It's just a way of grouping things. And so I wanted to see, kind of wanted to test out my theory, so to speak. And so I looked and I saw everything from a Reese's peanut butter cup to a cat offering a foot rub that was blessed. I saw a picture with dollar bills floating all around a woman with the caption blessed, and another that said your life is good and you're blessed, so call up and brag about it. And it had a link, but I was too chicken to click. I saw one of the cat with a caption that says, when they ask if you want a foot rub. Another one said, I am blessed with an incredible daughter. I said, okay. Another one that said, sometimes I just look up and say, I know that was you, God. And then the Reese's peanut butter cup with the words blessed. Now, maybe to some people that is blessed. But I have to tell you that the New Testament has many references to being blessed, and none of them have probably anything to do with any of the things that I saw. And neither does it have to do really with material prosperity. My point here is that if you hear an incorrect meaning of something for a long period of time or enough, then you start to believe it. And that is why I think that Jesus repeatedly used the word blessed so that it would get imprinted on our hearts and minds that we are the people who are blessed. Not because of what we have, but because of what we care about and what influences our actions. We are blessed because Jesus bestows a blessing on those who recognize their need for him and recognize and protect the innocent and those who cannot always fight for themselves. We are blessed because we have a hunger and a thirst for righteousness, Jesus said. The would-be disciples of Jesus showed that they were hungry and thirsty to know not only what to do, but they also wanted a reason to do it. Now, this teaching is labeled as the Beatitudes as we know it, which is taken from the Latin word for blessed. To be blessed is to pronounce one to be happy, one to be fortunate, but it's not happy in the sense that you think of it, because the opposite of happy, the way we would think about it, would be unhappy. That's not the way the scripture uses it. The opposite of happy, the opposite of blessed, rather, is cursings. If you look into Deuteronomy, you'll see there's two or three scriptures that talks about blessings and cursings. You are blessed because you are obedient to God, and you are cursed because you are disobedient to God. To be supremely blessed is a condition in which congratulations are in order. It means to be fortunate or well off. It is a grace word that expresses the special joys and satisfaction granted to the person who experiences salvation from God. So it is another way to think about God's favor. So you see, the significance here is not just in saying the words blessed upon the hearer, but in the fact that the Holy Spirit will endow these words with the power to bring them to pass. In the Bible, important persons were blessed those with less power or influence. The patriarchs pronounced benefits upon their children, often near their own deaths. So a pronounced blessing is so powerful that even if spoken by mistake, once a blessing was given, it could not be taken back. Do you remember when Isaac blessed Jacob instead of Esau? He could not take it back. He was sorry about it, but there was nothing he could do. The blessing was out. So God also blesses us by giving life and fruitfulness. Yet his greatest blessing is turning us from evil and forgiving our sins, and he won't take it back. Amen. When we bless God, we are showing gratitude to him as well. So Jesus says we are blessed. We are the fortunate ones. We are the ones who have God's favor when we have a hunger and thirst for righteousness. Yeah. When we think of hungering and thirsting for righteousness, this word righteousness in the New Testament is the same word that Micah called justice in Micah 6 and 8 that we just read. Jesus meant that we should have an appetite for justice. That is, we are blessed when we do this. When we care about justice, then we will think about justice, and we will act justly toward others. When we care about mercy, then we will think about mercy, and we will act mercifully with others. When I was at Glendale this past week, my teaching was on a psalm, Psalm 25 in fact, that talked about how all the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth. And I said that grace is what God gives us, the distinction between grace and mercy. Grace is what God gives us. He gives us favor that we don't deserve. But mercy, on the other hand, is God withholding the punishment that we do deserve. For if God were to give each one of us what we deserve, we would not be able to handle it. Our thought process should be then to hunger and thirst for righteousness, God's justice, rather than vengeance, which belongs to the Lord. He said, blessed are the meek or the humble. When we care about humility, then we will think about humility, and we will act and walk humbly with our God. We are blessed people of God, not because of what we do or just because of what we have, but because of what we care about. This was a new way of thinking for the people listening to Jesus preach. Now you may wonder to yourself, why does Jesus care what we think? It is precisely this. It is because our thoughts can do several things. Our thoughts can hold us back from doing something that God wants us to do. They can push us down and make us feel depressed. They can also feed us with things about ourselves and others that are untrue. Many times the things that we think or imagine that cause us to act in irrational ways. But just as our thoughts can work in a negative way, they can also lift us up. And that's what Jesus wanted these would-be disciples among those he called to come and see, because he wanted to change their thoughts in a positive way. And that's what he wants to do with us as well. He wanted to give them words of faith to live by, because our thoughts affect our outlook. So Jesus gives us a long list of declarations that teaches us that we need to also make daily declarations over our own lives. You see, sometimes when we feel run down and burned out, we think that it is a sign of us going in the wrong direction. But maybe, just maybe, it is a sign that we need to change the way we think. I know that it's true of myself at times. You see, all of life is significantly different when we change the way that we think. Our thoughts really matter. They affect our behavior, and I understand even today as I say this, that it is not easy to always change the way we think when we've been conditioned to think one way. But when we meet up with Jesus and his we are. But his thoughts are not our thoughts, and his ways are not our ways. We should not be mad about that. We should be glad. Because we don't want to serve a God that thinks like we do. The other reason that Jesus really cares what we think is because the mind is a battleground. When our minds get bombarded with cleverly devised patterns of little nagging thoughts and suspicions and doubts and fears and wonderings and reasonings and theories about a thing, although it is directly against the Word of God, it begins to entrap us into dismissing God's Word as truth. And there is so much more to say about this idea of the mind being a battleground, but not for today. It would take the rest of the day, actually. But I heard one person talk about how our thoughts take us captive, that I thought summed this up pretty good. Greg Crochelle said this. He says, our lives move in the direction of our strongest thoughts. And he said, mark it down, take it to the bank. If your thoughts are full of faith, full of God's truth, you are becoming more like Christ every day. Mm-hmm. However, if our thoughts are negative, toxic, polluted, and fear-induced, we will not live in victory. And we will struggle in our actions because our thoughts are far from God's truth. Philippians 2 and 5 says this, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And so God wants us to have his mind. That is another way of saying that we must resist the mindset of the world with its influences and take on the thoughts that matter to God. So Jesus says we are blessed when we are poor in spirit and depend on him. But the world says we are blessed when we are self-sufficient and have self-confidence. Jesus says we are blessed or fortunate when we mourn and desire to forgive and to be forgiven. When we hurt other people and see other people hurting. The world says we are blessed when we self-justify our actions toward others for our own personal comfort. Jesus says blessed are the meek, not the weak, meaning those who are obedient to God and willing to serve him. The world says blessed are those who have prestige and wallow in self-importance. Jesus says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, those who have a desire to grow, who have moral purity, self-control, and self-denial. The world says no, blessed are those who have personal freedom and material success and moral relativity. Jesus says, blessed are those who are merciful, who have compassion and are generous. The world says, blessed are those who are self-righteous. They have their own method of justice and are vengeful. Jesus says, blessed are those who are pure in heart, who have integrity, while the world says, blessed are those who are sophisticated and broad-minded. Jesus said, blessed are those who are peacemakers and have concern, social concern, and are people of justice and reconciliation, while the world says, blessed are those who are competitive, defensive, and assertive. Now, I hope you get the idea of why Jesus wanted them to come and see, and why his ways and his thoughts are different than our thoughts. And he says to us also, come and see the things that I care about. Come and see the things that matter to me. He says, justice matters to me. Blessing others matter to me. The nations matter to me. The poor, the homeless, the orphan, they matter to me. And what we think about these things matter to God. And they are so important that this is the first thing that he teaches us. We were in our missions meeting on Thursday night, and no one sitting there had any idea of what I was preaching today. And we were talking about being a blessing to our community, though we did not call it that. And we were tossing around some ideas about what to call a suggestion that came forth to prepare bags that would show we care about people who are suffering and who may not have the basic essentials that we use each and every day and take for granted. And Ben Parrington said, well, why don't we call them blessing bags? I wanted to jump up right then and just shout hallelujah, But I just quietly said under my breath, thank you, Jesus. So thank you, Ben. Jesus wanted them to come and see so that when they committed, they would know what they were committing to. He said that blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, who abandon the thinking that God does not care what we think and believe, because it does affect what we do. There is a future kingdom that we have talked about many times, yes, that we have to look forward to. But in the meantime, we have a present kingdom rule of God to obey. Jesus said that our faith would not be characterized by how deeply we love our friends. It would be characterized by how deeply we love our enemies. And if our version of the gospel does not include loving others who are different or who disagree with us, it is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have a living hope that is not only for the future, but it is grounded in obedience to the word of God. Now, in the meantime, we must try to engage our communities, and let us be mindful that we are blessed to be a blessing.
Yes.
You are blessed.
Yes.
You are blessed.
Yes.
We are blessed in this church, but not to keep the blessing to ourselves. We are blessed to be a blessing.
Amen.
God bless you. Father, we thank you. We thank you this day. Lord, I thank you to be a light. And Lord, I thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you for your truth. I thank you for your goodness. I thank you that you have blessed us. Lord, with a blessing that cannot be taken. And a blessing, oh God, that we appreciate so much. Lord, I ask that you would continue blessing this local church in Naugatuck. God, that we might be a blessing to this community, God, and the world that's in our purview. Lord, we thank you this day, and I ask, oh God, that if there's anyone in the sound of my voice that does not know you, and have not committed themselves to you, God, I pray that they would do just what the two disciples did. They would walk with you. They would listen to your word. And God, that they would ask you to bless them with your salvation. Lord, we thank and praise you this day for your goodness, for your grace, and your mercy. God, I thank you for these, your people, Lord, that we gather together to hear from you so that you can change the way we think, so that you can change the way we act. We love, honor, and adore you. In Jesus' name, let the people of God say, amen.